It's time to continue the higher education track. We are left with two sessions, and we have decided to merge both sessions due to scarcity of time. So the first session is utilizing technology to attract and retain students, to increase and improve student diversity, and to ensure efficient student lifecycle management. And next session, effective management of transnational education, reaching financial stability while providing high quality qualifications and an excellent student experience. We have a wide range of speakers and panelists in this session. To begin with, I would start with industry presentation, and later on we'll have a panel discussion of all the eminent panelists. So I request Dr. S. Nabi, Director, Learn Engineering, to please come on stage and give your presentation. Welcome him with a huge round of applause. Dr. Nabi.
Good evening. I am from InfoPlus Technology, Chennai. We are here to talk about the technical education, how the technology is impacting, what are different things are coming up. First of all, let me thank the organizer to giving us this opportunity to present this presentation. So whatever I am talking here is for the technical education, starting from graduate engineering, polytechnic, ITI, and the skill development courses. Let's look at it, the difference, what it has happened last 25-30 years in the academics of technical education. We had a BE 5 years course. The most of the syllabus are not well defined, or it is mostly solution oriented. We never bother about objective type questions before 90s. After the self-finance engineering college opened up, it became mostly 4 years course. Scoring mark became important, and the examination pattern continuously changing towards the objective type questions rather than getting into large answerable big size answer questions. That's what it has been there. Because definitely I can, very with confident I can tell, because graduated in 1986, started the whole career on CAD/CAM and digital education. So has the depth of the knowledge, what it has happened in the academics and in the technology. Let's take on the industry side, what it has happened on this 30 years. In the 90s, when you get selected for a Tata or any other large companies, the industry used to give 1 year graduate training program. It has gone totally now. Whatever the industry now say, give me industry ready students. We do not know where the industry readiness can be made, inside a classroom or inside an industry. That's a big question mark. Any debate can happen towards that. And the another thing is, before 90s, you had a lot of the students, engineering college student or a polytechnic students, had opportunities, or it is important for the student to do a industrial visits, which has been slotted in the academic calendar itself, has gone. It does not exist anymore. If maybe as an interested candidate, or they are doing it. But other thing is, whatever the skill building of individual, as of now, whatever the IT industry ask or core engineering ask, every industry looking for industry ready students. How do we, the academic going to address this biggest challenge now? And the technology, definitely we are having the best technology for learning and the teaching now currently, across from the school to the colleges, it is available. Then what it comes, the technology given me online education or e-learning. So most of the time, for the more than 10-15 years, the e-learning means it may be a PDF file or an e-book or a text in a remote, communicated from a remote location or through a server. Or what the next term it comes, including the government has done a lot of investments on the preparing this e-learning, which all monotonously lectured by a professor from the state capital to the all the engineering college in the state. That's called the EduSat educational system, which has come. But what it has happened is that a student, the previous sessions also, that was the discussion which was going. A continuous video, whether a professor is talking or a continuous video something is running, we have done a research for 2 years, find out what is the best for the technical education. I can tell you, in my technical classroom, if I run any video more than 5 minutes, I lost my 50% of class. I cannot attract any more. So that became a boredom. So what next my technology can ask for? That's what we are trying to evolve ourselves. Then as I said in the 2 minutes before, industry readiness, from where it can come. So it is now it is compulsion for academics to prepare the student with the skill. But what all the state governments or the policy making bodies across the country have looking at the skill development as a separate compartment. This is like you do a formal education in BE or a polytechnic or ITI, then join another course for skill development. The skill for a technical skill cannot come as a separate compartment where I can define first day to last day. Skill will not come through that. Until you acquire the skill need to be built over the skill knowledge, the skill development need to happen. So that's where the qualitative difference need to make. So what we have worked on the last 7 years, particularly how do we build application, the product which can go to the classroom or a self-learning by combining the industry learning as well as on the typical classroom learning. That's what we have came out with the 2010 visual rich e-content for technical education. That's where we have been working for last 7 years. We have only developed the content. Now we are into the market, started doing our implementation. Let me get back to you what we offer. We offer the one-stop e-content for the technical education for all branches and the all courses. It's a high-quality digital content, definitely, exploiting the technology on a visual side, and basically we use a lot of 3D models, what industries are using it. And then we also using the all personalized devices for that. The one more thing which I want to emphasize here is there are across the globe only two ways of learning technical, learning in a technical classroom or a technical learning. One is you learn the things through a fundamental concept. Another one is you learn things through application concept. Most of our Indian educational system advocate the fundamental learning system, that is you learn principle derivations, so solve the solution, at the last one line will be applications. If you go to a Western classroom, developed countries, where I am taught through applications, they will, for example, if I need to learn a DC motor, a professor will bring a prototype of DC motor, start doing, this is the DC motor we are going to study about, and he start doing the design details and go. At the end, he may leave the class, this uses the Faraday's law. Tomorrow the assignments are on Faraday's law, these are the assignments. This is how we dictate. But in our class, we do 50 minutes the complete Faraday's law derivations. Then while going out, we'll say this uses DC, this principle have been used in DC motor and the leave. So the most of our classes concentrate on the fundamental derivations problems, whereas the Western classes concentrate most on the applications. So what the solution we have evolved, combining the best of these two, came out this solution. That's what we are presenting it to you today. What's the other thing? The problem of the technology being imparting the academics is, for my student at the current rate, I cannot give anything extra. Anything extra, it's not accepted by the students. So what I can do is that we develop the content as per university syllabus. So that's the most important part is that last 7 years, 250 people have been working for 7 years, has developed complete visual for the different engineering branches. For example, you take a typical university subject, which is a 50 hour or a 45 hours, depending on the lesson planning university announces. That 50 hour lessons, we are converting to a 300 3D, 2D demonstration in a visual form. That means in a 1 hour class, I may take 4 minutes to explain that text oral communicated content or a blackboard writing to a visual form, 3 to 4 minutes video, which will come in 1 minute in slot. So the whatever the product we need to deliver to the Punjab Technical University or Anna University down south, we customize the content what we have built last 7 years as per their university. And one thing I can definitely can tell you is that we have not done copy of any internet material or taken some e-book copy. What we have done is built a remote contribution from my most of my our retired professors who are supposed to be the experts who has taught the very conventional form of engineering teaching in this. That's why a professor in the classroom definitely will say in 90s, imagine that it works like that. That has gone. That cannot be handled anymore. Now we can visually see these things. So what we have currently is that we have exclusively development completed for 225 engineering subjects across 10 branches of engineering, which can be applied to the different levels. And to explain these 225 engineering subjects, we have done 75,000 visuals developed. Each visuals are 1 minute and around. And we have done the more than 1 lakh people across the country currently using it. And we have been doing some of the government implementation, which I will come back in the next slide. Then the the NSQ framework, we have mapped up the whatever the content we are doing it according to the requirement what NSDF. The principle of this complete product is 3D way to learn. So we will complete whether it is understanding the fundamental law, working principle, derivation, this complete things we have provided. So we deliver through all the models, whatever the cloud model, you can get it in your Android tab. All those things are well known. I am not repeating it. Currently, we have done 77 government IDs of Kerala. We have done the implementation Andhra, Telangana, West Bengal on the polytechnic, government polytechnics. We are currently working with Visveshwara Technological University and the Pondicherry. And through our online portal, we are delivering to Anna University and 8 universities what we have listed. More than 75,000 users, and it is more than 100,000 hours have been used. That's what we have achieved so far. We are also recognized by Government of Kerala for the best rural Kerala student skill development for the 2 years implementation. I will make small implementation by that. I will complete my presentation here. So this is the product what we have developed. So this can be customized. Just I am making a demo of it. Here it is. This will be the content as per whatever the content university syllabus is giving it. It can be, if the regulations are changed, we can change the regulations. And here what we do is that we give the complete demonstration. This is what the demonstration, what we mean. So for example, a construction of a DC motor, we give so this will give the complete development in a 3D platform. This is all developed in the MCAD system and used the entertainment media to make these animations and other things. And this are built completely as per the requirement. What I mean the requirement is, in a class I am talking about construction detail, we give construction detail. Then it is getting into testing method, then the demonstration on the testing will come. So this will give you the complete demonstration. For example, what I said is that if you take the lesson planning of a DC motor, it will be 7 hour course. For that, we have 36 demonstration in a 3D framework we have developed for this. So this will completely cover the lesson planning, what it has been given on that. On the second part of it, what we have done is we have used 3D model explanation for the solving the problems also. For example, you take the typically in a tutorial class, professor will come and give the tutorial problem, then use the formula, get the answer. This is what typically happened. But what is the industry expectation or the skill knowledge related to is whatever the formula, whether I say voltage or the armature current. The armature current, it means where do I measure the armature current is a skill. Armature calculation is the skill. The parameterization of a motor comes from the tutorial problem. That's the impact we are not making it. So even the tutorial problem, we have completely managed with this, explaining the each content or the parameter of the problems through the, for example, you can see here, this is the motor.
The supply voltage is 220 volts.
So this, we will exactly use the 3D model, explain how it has been done. So this is how we have, each and every problem we have gone depth of this.
Armature current is 50 amps.
So armature current is measured, number of winding is this much. If it changes, what the current will
armature
change or the design will change
RA
is the parameterization.
Is 0.2 ohms.
So this is all will run for one minute or 1.5 minutes.
M.
The another typical technology, this one is that everyone is commenting is that who are you to give me the content, whether it is the full, not good enough for the student to study that. That what we have done is, we have, for when we are writing the content by experienced professor, we also taken a pain to get into the internet, whatever the different available content in the net for that specific topic, we have collected all those specific website location and given here. So that's the one thing, because what we say, the content, the examination point of view, understanding point of view, but if my student want to go beyond that, all that collection of material we have given. So this will give a complete end-to-end details what a student is requiring. So this is, will give you the better for the, in terms of not taking the classroom totally on a mark scoring basis, let understand the engineering through visuals and let do the skill development within the course, not as the separate compartment. Thank you very much. Thank you for the time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for completing your presentation within deadline. And I would request, sir, can we have you again on stage for 1 minute? I request Hemant Sethi, President, Elets Technomedia, to please come on the stage and present a speaker memento to Dr. S. Nabi, Director, Learn Engineering. Give him a huge round of applause. Thank you, sir. We have one speaker who has to catch his flight and he has to leave early, so he has requested to make his presentation earlier. I invite Dr. R. Karpaga Kumaravel, Professor and Head Department of Education, Central University of Tamil Nadu. Welcome him with a huge round of applause. And I request him to please keep his presentation within the time.
So it's my pleasure to deliver my presentation on the topic Higher Education Technology for Students. And the objectives of my presentation, to identify the ways and means of utilizing technology, how to make use of technology for attracting students, and how to make use of the potentials of technology to address the unique needs of the students. And let me take a quick historical perspective of Indian higher education, which is 159 year old, and the number of universities in 1970-71 103, and 2011-12 it has grown from strength to strength, and now it is more than 850. And we find that from 2007 onwards, there is a spurt in the growth of higher education institutions thanks to privatization in higher education. And Indian higher education system is the second biggest in terms of students' population in the world, and third biggest higher education system in terms of number of higher education institutions in the world. But in spite of that, we have just 17.9 gross enrollment ratio compared to American higher education system, which has 95% of gross enrollment ratio. And for want of time, I just skip some slides. And the private institutes, self-financing universities, self-financing colleges, they constitute a major player, and we find that 64% are private institutions and 59% of students, they study from private institutions and self-financing colleges. So students' enrollment in higher education has grown 12 times in the last 4 decades. And there is an increase in the gross enrollment ratio also. And we need to apply technology to reach the unreached, to reach the disadvantaged segment of the population through the development, application and evaluation of systems, techniques and aids to improve the process of human learning. And technology brings education to people instead of bringing people to education. And the basic philosophy is, for today's job, we should make use of today's tools. And we are now in the grey revolution, after green revolution, white revolution, and blue revolution. And the future need is equity in access to information and quality independent of geography. Now, I am suggesting some strategies. First one is technology integration for 24/7 learning experience. Enhanced technology integration. Advancing learning with technology will enhance overall student experience by helping to create the 24/7 learning experience. And second one, enhancing online learning efforts. Faculty require support in using technology, and instructional design support is needed to move the online learning efforts, including e-portfolios. Need for e-teaching methodology. India has acute shortage of teachers. To have equity and access, there is a need to e-deliver teaching besides providing tools for learning to the students. And it is the high time we establish the global classroom. Virtual courses can be developed with the international partner institutions. Expanding learning with technology allows for greater efficiency as web and software teaching resources become available for institutional effectiveness. And we should promote a campus digital culture, taking advantage of the most advanced educational tool technologies and practices, and adapt to changing and varied needs of students. Develop individually paced courses, web-based and modular experiences. And we should evolve strategies for student enrollment. Develop technology-enabled campaign for selection, orientation, and support programs for students using effective websites, mobile technology, and social media. And using technology to improve success rates of the examination. And technology should reduce barriers to intra-campus transfers and inter-university students' mobility through student-friendly technology. And we should increase out-of-state and international enrollments, reducing inbreeding. And tapping the mobile phone technology. As per the 2014 technology trend report, the number of mobile internet users of India is projected to reach around 160 million by March 2015. It is high time that we tap the potentials of this technology. And we should focus on doctoral growth, because higher education is known for knowledge generation and knowledge dissemination. And integrating web-based learning components into course materials. Faculty should be trained to integrate web-based learning components such as Blackboard into the management of course materials. MOOCs to massify higher education. MOOCs represent a global, low-cost, flexible and sustainable model to massify higher learning. However, the trends in enrollment and completion rates indicates that a majority of those enrolled in MOOCs are enthusiastic in enrolling but fail to maintain the same enthusiasm in completing the studies. So in India, we have constraints to expand MOOCs. First one is a technological constraint, second is language of instruction, third one is granting of credits and certification. MOOCs needs regular access to reliable broadband internet connectivity, which is not available at affordable prices, especially in rural India. Language constraint. The dominant language of communication in MOOCs is English. Many students in rural India are not in a position to cope up with English language proficiency expected to pursue the course. Issue of certification. A promise on certification and accreditation of the MOOC program will improve the completion rate of the courses offered on MOOC platforms. So these are all the issues in MOOCs. For want of time, I just skip over the thing. And now the need of the hour is blended course. A survey of 1,200 faculty and 80 vice chancellors by the Chronicle of Higher Education revealed that blended courses have higher potentials compared to MOOCs. So seamless integration of physical and virtual learning spaces, blended e-learning provides access to a wide choice of alternative resources. And student support services are very much possible through blended learning. And web-based student support and early introduction of e-administration and then 24/7 technical help desk. And now from MOOCs, we move to SPOC, Small Private Online Course. A small private online course refers to a version of a MOOC used locally with on-campus students. University of California, Berkeley, Professor Amado coined the word in 2013 to refer to a localized instance of a MOOC course that was in use in a business-to-business context. Research evidence in support of SPOCs. SPOCs support blended learning and flipped classroom learning, which combine online resources and technology with personal engagement. So, SPOCs versus MOOCs, colleges and universities can create SPOCs or license them. And recently, Harvard University announced SPOCs for its curriculum in the fall of 2013. Unlike MOOCs, SPOCs have limited enrollment and are often used as part of the course for credit. So, to conclude, our teachers have to be trained for three types of institutions: brick institutions, click institutions, and the blending type of institution, a hybrid variety of brick and click institutions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request Hemant Sethi, President Elets Technomedia, to present a speaker memento to Dr. R. Karpaga Kumaravel, Professor and Head Department of Education, Central University of Tamil Nadu. Big round of applause.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sanjeev Maini, and I come from a company called Nasis Dimension. We are typically a system integration organization focusing, one of the vertical that we focus on is the education sector. I was told to wrap it up my presentation in about 10 minutes time. I mean, it's virtually impossible to do it. The kind of inventions we have, but then I'll try to manage it within the time frame. Just to give you a highlight, NASIS is headquartered in Delhi and with the branch offices in Bangalore and Chandigarh. We are perhaps the, not perhaps, I think we are the fastest growing organization in the SI world, crossing 100 CR this year. Last few years, we've been managed to work with one of the largest central government as well as the state government organizations, certified on ISO 9000, now enrolling for CMMI3. We also carry the DGSND rate contract, which is one of the prestigious one that we have for data management and network security. We work with what we've been able to do is to create an ecosystem, partner ecosystem, and we work with one of the best, you know, in the industry. We as an organization is, you know, consider ourselves to be extremely credible organization. Reason being, your data and my data is actually being secured by, you know, NACIS dimension. The Aadhaar is actually we do the complete digital security, you know, so we've done the SOC for them. Moving forward to the industry specific challenges, we feel the cost, you know, to cut down the cost while improving the quality of education to be delivered is a big challenge. Globalization, more and more foreign universities are now, you know, getting into India, bringing students, our teachers across the globe together to cut down the distance factor is a challenge. How do we make sure that, you know, by leveraging technology, how can we reach to the remotest area in their native language? I mean, we just heard in our previous presentation. So that is real a big challenge today in the industry. Education for all and everywhere is a big challenge. You know, today morning we had a session with the CM of Jharkhand, and he mentioned about the problem of, you know, taking the education to the remotest area, you know, is a big challenge within the state, and that's the story everywhere. Demand of transparency in the education industry, you know, it has to be, you know, well regulated and so on and so forth. And of course, the last but not the least, security and safety of our people, you know, is a concern. So what I try to do out here is to, you know, create one slide, you know, wherein I can create an ecosystem. This is what we have done, you know, from the technology standpoint. This ecosystem has takeaway for all the stakeholders within the education, you know, industry, be it students or parents or the administrators and, of course, the faculty. So what we have done is we have integrated various, you know, technologies from the hardware side, from the software side together, and worked them seamlessly to get a, you know, takeaway for all the stakeholders within the entire system. So virtual class e-learning is one of the area that was, you know, lot of people have talked about it, but then how do we transform that into a student performance is a big challenge, right? And similarly, parents, you know, the biggest challenge for the parent is biggest, you know, concern for the parents are the safety and security of their children, plus the quality of education that they get, you know, from the institutes. That is the concern. So we try to solve that, you know, by leveraging, you know, different technologies. Faculty will have their own, you know, issues. You know, most of the time, faculty members spend more time doing the administrative work than actually the core business. Similarly, the administration and the business institutes, you know, they will have their own concern how to monetize, you know, various, you know, services that they you know, render to people, to students. So we have, you know, one side we have the virtual classes and e-learning, you know, platform that we have built, you know, with our partner, PeopleLink. We have our own homegrown ERP, end-to-end ERP that we have integrated with the e-learning platform. Similarly, the RFID solutions are being integrated for security and safety concerns, backed up by the CCTV and surveillance, you know, video analytics system. Just to wrap it up on the RFID and student tracking system and, you know, attendance management system, It's fully integrated. The student comes out of house, goes to bus, school or institute, and then roam around within the campus, and then finally go back home by using the same transport. So how do we ensure that, you know, he has actually fulfilled all the activities of the day is a concern for parents as well as the teachers. So we have this solution called STS, which is called Student Tracking System, by the use of RFID and, you know, a host of applications that we built. You can actually monitor each activity of the student on hour-to-hour and real-time basis. I'll talk about a little bit of virtual classroom for e-learning suite that we have. It's an end-to-end classroom, central classroom solution that we have, and this could be made available to you on-premise basis or on cloud basis, actually. We work with a company called PeopleLink quite extensively on this. So we built our application around, you know, their application as well. The best part about, you know, the virtual classroom that we have, you know, in contrary to the competition that we have, is, you know, BYOD, which is bring your own device. We don't want you to buy expensive equipment, you know, from us or from, you know, any of the competition. So we have built a platform wherein, you know, your mobile phone can be integrated and be a part of this entire, you know, virtual classroom and e-learning. That means you can now, by using 2G or 3G, you can actually you can reach out to the remotest area of, you know, places. And this was the concern that was shown by the Chief Minister himself today in the morning. So we've been able to, you know, somehow answer this query, that we have a solution which allow you to bring your own device and integrate and make that a part of the entire e-learning process. Few products, we have the MCU, which is the heart of the e-learning platform. Then LED backed up by the superior cameras, projectors. One of the invention that PeopleLink has is the e-podium. You know, we've done that. We've showcased that in our booth, booth number 24. Wherein, you know, it's a you can actually have a e-podium integrated to the system. You can actually manage a lot of, you know, things from here, including the electricity and the electronic devices, you know, from the single pump. We do have, as I mentioned, we do have our own homegrown ERP application focused on campus. It's designed for multi-campus institutions. It's been rolled out in 20 plus universities with over 20 fully integrated modules, cover widest range of functions. It's an open source, architected, product. So that means you don't have to buy the most expensive and these expensive Microsoft of the world and Oracle of the world. You can actually use, the Linux-based, the front end, and the Postgres kind, database, which is again open source. We do have the library management system, which is fully automated and backed up by our, another technology initiative, backed up by RFID. So you have a complete end-to-end, e-library system, which works seamlessly with the ERP solution. This is the framework that we have. It's pretty cluttered, actually. But then it's all I want to say is, one side is the front end processes that we have, whether it is a admission process, or the courses and so on and so forth, and then the back end processes such as HRMS, finance, inventory, and hostel management and so on. So we cover up pretty much everything, in this. I think, this is what I have today to summarize. You can get back to us. We are in booth number 24. I will be delighted to have you there. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sanjeev. I request Fahim Ul Haq, National Sales Head, to please come on stage and present a speaker memento to Mr. Sanjeev Kumar Mani, CEO, NASA's Dimensions Solutions. Can we have speaker memento on the dais? Music, please. Big round of applause. Now, we have one more presentation from Academia ERP. I would request and invite Mr. Arpit Barjatia, CEO and MD, Academia ERP. Welcome him with a big round of applause.
I am here to talk about automation of processes through softwares. And I will be starting with a short, interesting video, which will help us just set the context right. Can we have the computer connection back? Yes, so that video was actually, to my mind, pure magical, and it drove home the point that for magic to happen, and it can happen anywhere, it can happen in our educational organizations as well, we need coordination, communication, feedback, reporting, decision making, and we saw a great amalgamation of all of those coming together for that magic to happen. And it has become increasingly important that all those five things happen in our educational organizations in the 21st century, especially amidst these challenges. And I know that these would have been discussed in multiple panel discussions as well. So I'll skip it, but it's primarily about changing student expectations and the market dynamics underlying. And in view of those challenges, my vision for the 21st century campus of how it should operate is something which is student-centric, not bound by time and place, constantly measuring and communicating the progress, and I think that is really pivotal, and continually renewing its commitment to students and the community. And to achieve that vision, according to me, you need a trilogy of right team, right teaching, and right technology. I'm sure that all of, you know, there are many universities, colleges that we visit, we work with, and we've seen and schools, and we believe that there are fantastic people there and there are right teaching happening. But where we really add value is about right technology. And technology is currently being offered in e-learning, smart boards. There's a lot of solutions that you might have heard. But I believe that one of the most critical tools in adoption of technology in higher education and school segment in India today is about ERP for educational institutions. Because an ERP is actually the nervous system for an institutional technology ecosystem around which all your other components can play, and this can sit right in the middle for efficient operation. We will be talking more about specifically what we have to offer, but these are some suggestions that I had in what are the key points, again, basis our experience of working with about 175 institutions across India, what are the things that we should keep in mind before really taking that leap. And I think some sort of preparation with regard to, are you ready for the change that is going to happen when an ERP comes through? Is there a universal buy-in that has been secured, which means that there's obviously all stakeholders that get impacted? Have you had a chat with them, a word with them, and gotten them into the buy-in? Have you started from the bottom, so you know, included the entire hierarchy? Do you have reasonable and clear expectations from that project? Have you defined your requirements before you move into an exercise of an ERP implementation? Have you defined where you need to be tomorrow with this implementation? And ultimately, do you know which is a vendor which has the right domain experience and expertise? And today I'm here to present quickly one of the options for the ninth block that I've said, a vendor with very good domain expertise and experience who can deliver the goods with a solution called Academia. That's our solution. It's Academia ERP by Serosoft Solutions. That's the company name. And we are focused on schools, colleges, universities with a slight bias on higher education. These are some of the questions that I'll pose quickly for all of you here in this August audience. Do you believe you're facing problems in managing data across multiple colleges and programs? I know there are vice chancellors of leading universities sitting here, and they have multiple colleges within the university. Do you have a problem consolidating that data? Are you investing time in data collection and maybe some sort of excessive paperwork? Are you facing huge capital investment in some of the small pieces of islands of softwares that you might have purchased? Are you unable to analyze and generate comprehensive reports when you really require them at the click of a button? Are you troubled by lack of accountability? Do you find it difficult to manage databases? And ultimately, are you looking as a vice chancellor or a principal or a director or as a head to get absolute control on processes? That's my first set of questions. Another set of questions that I'd like to pose to you is about having, do you wish to evaluate student, faculty, and staff performance on a regular basis? Do you wish to have a single platform of communication for students, faculty, staff, and management? And ultimately, do you want a scalable and reliable platform to manage your institution effectively? And I'm sure to a lot of these questions, your answers would be an emphatic yes. And that is exactly where Academia comes in. So with Academia, all your departments, processes, functions get automated and streamlined. And this leads to enhanced transparency, better productivity, and greater control. Moving on, these are some of the capabilities of Academia. It can talk to your website portals. It has SMS and email-based alerts. We integrate with all the leading LMSs like Blackboard. Moodle is very popular these days and is, as an open source LMS. Accounting softwares, biometric machines. We also have smartphone apps, so it's mobile-ready software in that, and that's an increasing trend that we are seeing across Indian institutions. Coming to the bird's eye view of what all aspects of your university, college, or school, Academia will impact. So this is a bird's eye view, and I will not go into much of the detail today for the want of time. But starting with organization setup, we go to, you have your inquiries and campaigns where, you get your entire pre-admission processes managed. Then this would go through an admission process, which can be very complicated in terms of certain universities. It can be straightforward in terms of direct admission in some places. So all those processes are managed, leading to programs and courses, your fees and payments, examinations, completions, student portals, faculty portals, the complete rules around graduation, proceeding to the next level, and allied administrative modules like the HR, payroll, inventory, library, assets, transport management, system administration, messaging engines, ability to print documents directly off of the ERP, and having very, very diverse reporting as part of the solution. So that is, in a nutshell, what we can offer to you. I know it's late, so I would have ideally liked to walk you through some of these features, but we'll skip it for the want of time, so you can keep going, Ankit. Yeah. So we'll just give you a quick snapshot. We'll keep rolling it up. So in admissions, yeah, keep going. In admissions, we are able to handle all kinds of complex processes. For example, there can be multi-stage processes, single stage. Fees and payments, we're able to handle any kind of fee scenario, which could be installment-based pay, discounts, scholarships, different fee structures for different seat types and different students from backgrounds. Examination is usually critical for everyone, where you have to have now increasingly evolving methodologies to evaluate students. And CCE is popular in school as well as, I mean, in universities and colleges also, you need the continuous evaluation processes. So these are all compliant. We have messaging, scholarships. Keep going. Yeah, asset management, along with the purchase process and so on. Hostels, so your student housing, accommodation, completion, which is very critical, which means that what are the rules that really govern a student to progress from one level to the other? And these can be really complex. In a credit hour-based system, these could be different. In a marks-based system, these could be different. And we have kind of thought through every single scenario, having been in this sector for 8 years and just focusing on one single product. Faculty, portals, and then we have service request management. This is one key where we have incorporated a ticket management system where any person who needs any request can always raise a ticket and it will be tracked like a corporate whether it has been resolved by the relevant authority or not. And it gets auto-escalated based on the hierarchy that you define in the system. So, you know, the whole idea is to bring in a lot of transparency, efficiency, communication, and collaboration. These are some of the key benefits. I will not go into it. Efficient work and process flow. This is one area where I'd like to highlight why we are different. First of all, we can really work well with all kinds of formats of education. And when I say that, it can be universities, colleges, it can be different grading patterns, different evaluation patterns, different fee structures, and so on. There's a high configurability that we have built in. One of the things that we observed while working with so many universities is there's constant changes that are required. And if you have to really go into the code and make changes to the code, it often makes it costly, expensive, and unstable. So what we have created is a configurable engine right in the system where you can change a lot of things from the front end and the system evolves in that way. And this is one key which is absolutely outstanding about academia, and we have built it in on very rigorously. Apart from that, there's obviously a lot of host of other things, again, not covering it today. It's been built on Java J2E technologies. We've been featured in a lot of press, ET Now, some of our clients. I'm also a consultant to the Association of African Universities and advising them on how to automate processes across institutions in Africa. This was a video we were featured on ET Now. You can keep going. These are some of our clients across Africa, Middle East, India, Asia Pacific, and it's a product that's growing very rapidly. Then one of the key things is how do we implement it? So I'll just take one more minute and I'll wrap up. So in the implementation, we go with the standard product, and then our team comes to the campus and really does a gap analysis based on what you really require in terms of your formats. We configure the solution based on that, train the people on various formats, and then go live with it. Why academia? As I've already said, it's a technologically and superior product, and our focus is just education with this product. That's the only thing we do. And we love the opportunity to partner, and it's time for coffee, maybe after some time. Last thing, just half a minute, I'd like to show you some screenshots, and I'll end it with that. Just so that you have a glimpse of what I've been talking about. So these are some, we have included a lot of dashboards, which helps various users at each level, from top management to the individual students and teachers as well. Pre-admission abilities, and then, there's a lot of graphics, analytics that we've built into it. Admission processes, you can have a lot of demographic reports and so on. Selection process, like I mentioned, is very efficiently tracked. Programs, again, you know, this is the kind of configurability. You can define a lot of parameters right here from the front end, and this really drives the ERP from there. Then we have timetables, student course enrollments, examinations, all kinds of grading. We are able to handle grade points, percentages, letter grades, etc. So there's a lot of deep domain expertise that we have built in, examination related stuff, fees and payments, online payment gateways can be integrated, mobile wallets, etc. Completion, students, this is a very detailed student profile where we keep a track of every single activity about a student within the system, employees, various tools and services, transport, hostel, and other administrative aspects as well. Users and roles, and then we have different integrations like the applicant portal for, and then we integrate with social media like Google Plus, LMSs, and so on. So that was our idea of just presenting a quick thing. Thank you for your time today. Please meet us at booth number 30 tomorrow if you'd be interested for a chat. Thank you, sir. That's the most difficult question I've been asked in a forum like this. No, I can tell you for a fact that it is reasonably priced. And it will not burn a hole, and it is certainly very competitively priced. I mean, okay, so let me say competitively priced in wake of the other solutions that do exist in the market. And for the kind of technology upgrade that we have done, see, we have been doing this for 8 years. I was in the US, I moved back to India just to start this company, and our sole mission is to make this the number one product on the earth. So, you know, we are just investing way too much into the product every single day. Our entire team of about 125 people is just focused on this. So in terms of costing, we have to be competitive, otherwise we'll be outpriced in the market. So yeah, we have two models. One model is a license, which you can buy and then pay us an AMC every year. And you can also have per year, per student pricing. Then you can have hosting on the cloud, or you can have it on premise. I can tell you that the value to cost equation is heavily loaded in the client's favor in our product.
Thank you. Thank you, Arpit, for this wonderful presentation. And huge round of applause for Arpit.
Thank you, sir.
And I invite Gaurav Srivastav, Senior Manager and Vertical Head BFSI, Elets Technomedia, to present a speaker memento to Arpit Barjatia, CEO and MD, Academia ERP. Big round of applause. We have one more industry presentation, and after that we have a panel discussion of university VCs. So before I invite Latesh KJ, Vice President, Technical ZFS Software Technologies Private Limited to the stage, I would request all the university VCs to please present inside the hall. After this presentation, we'll have panel discussion. I invite Sanjeev for his presentation. Welcome him with a big round of applause.
I'm done in quickly, and I'll do it exactly, well within 5 minutes, okay? So we already, since morning, like so many ERP applications being roamed on your head. So I'm gonna only talk about the key features where exactly it will help the, you know, universities in bringing down their challenges in daily operations, right? So myself, Latesh KJ, and I serve with ZFS Technologies as a vice president. I spent close about 15 years of industry in HP, okay, like this globalization company, and I've served academia as also as an assistant professor for close about 7 years across India as well as in Malaysia. So ZFS is a group of companies. Basically, we are not only into ERP and software. So we have got software technologies other than software, right? We all the time tie up with academies so that What exactly after the graduation? So the core part of CPSC is something like, we do immigration process for those students who are willing to go out from India to pursue the higher education or to pursue their job career. So that's our fourth vertical, which is talk about something called CPS immigration. And other than that, we've got something called CPS projects, where we already started close about 5 years ago, that we came with a thought like incubation, wherein we meet all the universities and then identify the core young youth, you know, smart brain, and then pull them in our operations, in a live operations where they can promote and build their own patent act, and they can start up their own companies. So that's what all about something called CPS project. And one of the key example where the success story has happened with us is something called Silk Sari. So where one of the key university from Malaysia, where we are tied up, we have raised close about 17 patents on how exactly a product can be launched. To give a simple example, so the silk sari is all about something like sari manufacturing, right? Every woman buys a sari, but there is no product like which would do a rotation. In this particular the startup event, what we have done is, there's a set of algorithms which we have placed with the university people, where key strength has been delivered by the young youth, okay, intelligence. So where they wrote some sort of a programs with our help, now the sari would rotate and a woman would be able to replace her product on it. Let's say if I go on my product line and she goes to a wide range of cart and picks up a product or probably a sari. Now she can put her face or whatever, right, image, and it goes onto the model. Now she can feel herself inside the sari and put it in the cart. So this was one of the key projects with the startup that we have started on CPS. So these are the quite areas like where we have been identified by Ministry of Government of India, MHRD, AICTE for our ERP applications. These are the few areas where we support ERP into multiple segments. Start with kiosk, web solutions, ERPs, media automation, and rest of the solutions. So now I'm going to directly a few concerns and questions with the respected VC sitting here. Like, most of the time, every ERP on this earth, when they say like, we do a lot of automation, everybody says the same, right? There is something called A to A, that's from admission to alumni. So that's the primary picture of every ERP should be, right? So we have identified the core ICT challenges, how exactly it can be taken care from the ERP solutions. So one of the few challenges that we are addressed here, I will going to talk only about the key modules that we have in our system. As per like the most of the ERP application that we have the similar product line. I'm going to talk only one key feature that's called examination module. Let's say in a big university, right, close about running about more than 400, 500 programs, right, they need to set up a timetable or they need to conduct an examination. The room placement is a big challenge when an examination is to be made. So we have a system, right, where you will going to create your timetable using our solution, or probably you can create it on any other Microsoft apps like Word, Excel. It will accept the timetable into the place. Now on the day of the examination, what you can do, right, to keep the examination hall very tight and clean, right, there would be a desk or a dais placed for the examination where the people would come and write the examination. The system will automatically accept the subjects, okay, in two verticals, vertical A and vertical B, mixes itself automatically and puts the data onto the solution, and it will automatically allots the students for the particular subject or at the particular day. And we have tested close about up to 8 lakhs of subjects can be handled in a per day timetable examination places. Once the examination room allotment is done, now the next question is preparing the room diaries and room allotment copies. Now that is also automatically via the solution it is produced, because we have already data in the system. Now after that, now a student can, you need not to worry about like when is my exam, you know, which particular room it is, because we know that university campus is so big, right? So what he can do is he can touch his from app or probably even from the campus network or any media which is connected inside the LAN, say something like where do I sit. The moment when he clicks where do I sit, all he need to just put his register number, so-called USN, university seat number, then automatically system will tell him, Buzz, this is your place, this is the room, this is the subject, this is the seat number as well. So that's one key feature that I'd like to showcase on the system solution. And after that, there's something called university means like a hell lot of paperwork, since from the chancellor respected till the lower portion of people, till the student as well as to the parent. We have something called e-office paper or e-paper movement, where you create your own document or probably a circular or a notice or a governance or whatever. That particular piece of content will be on a hierarchy basis, moves around the place. Each responsible person would be handling the paper, or he does the operation with the software flow. Now you'd be able to easily track who has done what, why is it lagging. So you can easily take out the time, and there would be a support ticket similar to academia that it would take out and make a counter. If your particular person is not addressing or not referring to that particular circular or whatever, then automatically it gets escalated to the next immediate superior so that he can take an action on it. So like this, from the examination system, so there is one university called AEU in Malaysia, and close about OCDs, 34 universities across APAC, which they have close about saved 1.2 tons of paper in, you know, writing down this examination on the on sheet of papers, which we have entirely moved into solution. Coming into the external examination process, we have a solution where even from starting with the booklet till the evaluation system, a complete system is made, which is called as CCE port or external portion of examination. Just to say that, one single booklet would have identified different barcode number, and system will automatically scan the barcode number. Now it will be available to the evaluators. Evaluators can evaluate the system. There's a key feature that we added in the evaluation system is that, let's say there is a 5-mark question and the people has answered it. Now I would like to say, why is that only 3 marks are given to it? The evaluator can digitize using a pen, he can justify that why is this only given. Based on the track of the system, the results are omitted and it will be for use basis. So we have one more key feature, like most of the time when the solution is plugged, from the software industry we say like, we are at your time. But there are certain situations when the real production is happening, like people are using the solution, unidentified pop-ups or error might or panic situation might come. In our solution, we have a system just like your cell phone, where you can capture your phone and send, photos and send. The solution will automatically capture anything which is suspicious and port it us. Before you reply us, you write a panic message that something has happened to you, we will come back saying that, so this is the issue created because of this solution, and he was the user using this particular solution, and we give you a solution on that. So that we something called as 24-bar support-based program. And higher the line, I would like to talk about something called information security. Since I was already with Hewlett Packard, leading about your security issues, every day we swipe cards and ATM boxes, which runs with a protocol called NFS protocol, so which we have integrated in our operations. There would be a 3 layers of data security, one on the back-end side, one is on the business logic, and one is on the user end. Let's say you all feel like my data is on the cloud, and what is the guarantee that it is secure, right? We have a clear, transparent system where you would be able to access your own database, look at any time. The data which goes sits inside the backend is completely encrypted. Now you can say like, since it is encrypted, somebody knows the logic that how it is encrypted, he can decrypt. For that, we'll allow you to put your own key, just like the day first day when you receive a PIN code for your debit cards or credit card, there would be a small rectangular box, there would be a secret key pin stored there. Something like that, we enable your solution where you can just put your own security key and your system or solution becomes 3 layers secured so that your ERP solution running absolutely fine with the solution. As per that, the key features that I would like to indicate here, we have industrial training program. We do internships on the campuses, and we do a edge cutting product development with Lai University to identify the core strength of the student, and we help them to start up, have their own startup as an incubation center. And we have R&D unit which sits in Malaysia, where we can tie up with all the universities to help them how they, energetically they can propose new ideas, where both university and company can be recognized. For rest of the operations, like we are resided here at the Blue number 38, please drop in us. We would be able to give you a small amount of time and we can schedule a proper sort of a demonstration where you'll be identifying the core strength of the product. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Latish. Thank you for wonderful presentation. And I invite Assistant Editor, Elets Technomedia, Karthik Sharma to present a speaker memento to Latish KJ, Vice President, Technical, Zephyr Software Technologies Private Limited. Can we have a speaker memento on the dais? Applause. So now I invite Vice Chancellors of various universities for a panel discussion. Post that, we'll have Education Leadership Awards and Felicitation Ceremony. To begin with, I would like to invite Professor Vinay Kumar Pathak, Vice Chancellor, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Technical University, Lucknow on the dais. Please take your seat, sir. Welcome him with a big round of applause. H.A. Raja Saab. A.H. Raja Saab, Vice Chancellor, Tumkur University, welcome him with a huge round of applause. Professor I.K. Bhatt from Malviya National Institute of Technology, Jaipur, big round of applause. Narendra S. Chaudhary, Director, Vishwesaraya National Institute of Technology, VNIT Nagpur, and MANIT Bhopal. Big round of applause. Professor Rupa Manjari Ghosh, Vice Chancellor, Shivnadar University. Professor B.A. Chopra, Vice Chancellor, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, Marathwada University. Big round of applause. Dr. S.K. Salwan, Vice Chancellor, APJ Satya University, Gurgaon. Big round of applause. Professor Vijay Kant Verma, Vice Chancellor, ISECT University. Professor HL Verma, Vice Chancellor, Jagannath University. Professor Arvind Dhar, Vice Chancellor, NIILM University, big round of applause. Dr. Raj Singh, Vice Chancellor, Rayat Bahra University, big round of applause. Gagan.
Cheers.
Yes, yes, we'll arrange. Please add more chairs. And Dr. Mohit Dubey, Pro Vice Chancellor, IFTM University. Big round of applause. Please add two chairs.
Remove this.
And I would request Professor Vinay Kumar Pathak, Vice Chancellor, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, Technical University, to moderate the session. And request you to please keep timings in mind. We have to start award function. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
So welcome to the session, and the session is happening in a late evening session. I think Vice Chancellors and Professors are not in tune with this kind of a late session, but welcome you all in the last session. And So one thing is utilizing technology, and this is one of the session which I have said, utilizing technology with the education, which is very hot topic in the sense. And the other was effective management. So the organizers told us that we have to merge this kind of thing. On our dais, there are people who have invested their whole life in education and use of technology. And to me, just from starting from the moderation so that we can go around and all of us, you know, the panelists who are there, the co-panelists, are people of a great eminence. The technology which has taken place in the terms of education is a revolution which we are all facing. And to me, we have graduated out from an education, from a textbook, seen the transformation in the name of the open courseware and all other things, and went and seen the era of MOOCs. We are the people who have seen universities. After the Industrial Revolution, the universities were known. People know Oxford, Cambridge, MIT, Stanford. And today people know professors. With this IT technology, to me, the paradigm shift which has taken place is people or students are not recognizing the university, but they are recognizing the professors. And the kind of the power for the cooperative learning has increased exponentially. The classes which happen to be one to many has changed from many to many. There are many to many problem solvers. There are many to many people who can go with the kind of education. And there are many people who are solving problems also offline using the technology. I had a privilege before this to be a vice chancellor in the two open universities, one at Uttarakhand and one at Rajasthan. And Rajasthan, I was there in Kota, which is famous for its kind of the coaching it has for medical and thing. And believe me, the young people, the young guys are great problem solver, and they used to solve the problems online, and now they are getting a lot of money out of this. I think both topics are important. Before I hand over to the people of our kind of a thing, one thing which is very important for us in the social perspective is to see that our education is leading to a social fabric. Maybe we are imparting technology and all other things. That's a very important point, that the social fabric and the kind of thing which we hear from the kind of terror and Naxalites, which is also done by technology savvy people, so, and very learned people. So this is also a new phenomena which has taken over. So I think all of us can deliberate, and speakers will do one round. We will say something in 1 minute or 2 minute or 3 minutes, and then we will be open for the question or anything in the panel discussion. We can start from start. We'll start from okay. I will wait.
So I'm H.L. Verma, presently Vice Chancellor, Jagannath University, Haryana. So it is a part of GIMS group. Now the topic which was assigned to our group, that was transnational education. That effective management of transnational education, reaching financial stability while providing quality qualifications with excellent student experience. Now all these three things, that transnational education and achieving financial stability with quality education and student satisfaction, as a student of management, I understand it is a great challenging task. Things are changing with this globalization, IT revolution. Everything has changed. And there are a lot of implications on the education sector as well. Now in this changed scenario, this transnational education, it is said it is growing, and to keep pace with the rest of the world, so it will further grow More and more students are going for that education. I have my very little experience about that transnational education. I have two experiences. One is that in my previous university, APJ Sattaj University, we signed an MOU for ACCA degree of UK. The arrangement was that ACCA syllabi course content to be incorporated in our BCom BBA syllabi, and the students will pay a certain amount of fee in pounds to the ACCA, and in lieu of that, so they will provide the study material and will train our teachers and will conduct the examination. The rest of the things were to be done by the university. That was one experience. Second was in my present university, similar sort of agreement we have signed for CMA degree to be a part of the BBA and BCom program. Now in both the cases, my experience is that it was not a success story. Not many students opted for that. We analyzed it, tried to find out the reasons. Right, please, only 2 minutes I will take. So the reasons were, number one, affordability, fee structure. That this transnational education is focused on middle class. Already the type of fee structure we have in self-financing institution is not sustainable. That is my personal understanding, that in the long run, we can't afford to have this type of fee structure that where whole of the cost of education is passed on to the students, to the middle class. So extra cost in terms of foreign currency, dollars, pounds, that is one issue. Second issue was recognition. The degrees, ACCA degree, our MHRD, UGC, they allow for such type of arrangements. But the other professional bodies don't recognize. It means we are awarding unrecognized degrees to the students. Quality was an issue. So our other partners, they have made no investment. The same infrastructure, same faculty, in the same environment, is delivering the courses. So quality was an issue. Rather, there were certain things in that arrangement that if you pay a certain extra fee, then Oxford Brookes University will award you a second degree. Now, what is this? So this type of arrangement, so in case of transnational education, so there are very serious issues. Quality is an issue. Financial part is an issue. Student satisfaction is an issue. So its effective management is very important. Now sometimes question comes into the mind that do really we need support from foreign institutions to promote our quality? We have our rich heritage, culture. We proudly talk of our ancient education system. Can't we improve the things? The only thing is we need investment, public funds, public finance need to be provided for the education sector. So, and our people are capable and we can improve the things at our own. So that is my observation, that this transnational education in India particularly. So there are very serious issues regarding that. Thank you.
I'm Professor Verma. I'm Vice Chancellor, ISECT University, Bhopal. Today, we have moved from expansion of education to questioning the quality of education. And I was called for a session in which transnational education was to be discussed with its quality aspect and management aspect. I think the transnational education has a solution for question of quality. transnational education is form of internationalized education where the course or program moves to the country where it is being provided. So the cost is cut down to quite a bit. It is very popular in Europe. It is very, very popular in Holland and some other countries like Australia. In India, we are at the initial stage, and when Prime Minister Narendra Modi went to England with Cameron, he declared that 2016 will be the year of education, research and innovation. And in that, transnational education has to play a very important role. Now, the strength of transnational education is also its weakness, because transnational education, the cost will cut down to quite a bit, but that will result in also the quality going down. That is the biggest problem, which has to be seen by both the parties. And national framework, the regulatory framework, is another aspect, because the providing country doesn't have any control where it is being imparted. So these are the big issues which has to be sorted out by the regulatory framework, and I hope in the education policy which is coming out, these will be looked after. And the advantage of transnational education will give to a lot of competition, and it has to move to transnational research also. Then the quality will be certainly becoming. And ISEC University is into MOU with a couple of universities in USA and Australia. And we hope that we will make good of this facility to improve the quality of education and research by bringing in foreign brand of education, their quality, and other aspects of education. Thank you very much.
Thank you. There are a few points which I want to raise about the education of higher education in general. Students, parents, and the public in general tends to rank and appreciate the education student by the measurement of success of their student. Unfortunately, the primary measure of this success is ability to secure economic gain. It is still extremely hard to make a convincing argument in the terms of love for knowledge or freedom to explore in the face of hard monetary consequences, which is capitalistic age is often primary concern. A university with no means immune to market forces, it must pay its bill and attempt to present a clear value proposition to those who will apply to it. This struggle plays out especially and when the university has to build up sufficient resources in terms of brand equity and share wealth to be able to buck societal and political pressures. Two more points. Number one, the university should continue to be the place where young men and women experiment with their minds and bodies to further push their understanding of the human existence. Knowledge should come from wherever it is possible, and we must accept the knowledge, maybe other nations or transnational agreements. An environment must be created where they can safely embark on this exploration. They extend particularly towards the academic, where traditionally students have been forced to look themselves into a single field without the opportunity to experiment and try different fields. And that is where the MET education and liberal art concept comes into picture. Thank you.
Sir, may I want an apology from all the panelists and the delegates. Actually, as you are aware, we are running a lot of delayed time, and we are aware that the panel is very late already. We had requested Shri S.C. Kuntia, Subhash Kuntia ji, who is the Joint Secretary, I'm sorry, secretary of the school education ministry of HRD. Sir is here, I missed his busy schedule, and he was like, we pulled it out of some meetings which he was still at the ministry. And may I request that we use the opportunity to have the education leadership awards, which he had announced was supposed to happen right now. So if we can do that with his presence in the next 15 minutes, and then we go ahead with the panel. So if you allow us. Okay, 1 minute each. And so we are like really short of time, and I really apologize. Yeah, okay. So 8:12 is the time, and aapka samay shuru hota hai ab. So, yep.
Thank you. May I proceed, Mr. Chairman? First, let me thank elets for bringing all of us together here, academia, industry, and policy makers. It's a good move, and we had a good day, and I thank elets on behalf of all of us. My fellow delegates and also delegates from Karnataka, I am very happy to say here Karnataka is a leading state in ICT initiatives, and we have experienced many of these presentations today. Now the point is, allowing private universities, deemed universities for general cause of education in India is the one which is debated everywhere, and in my opinion it is necessary, because more than 50-60% of the stakeholders are trained in the private universities. Then with regard to the ICT initiatives, there are more than 60-70 ICT initiatives which we have implemented in Karnataka. They are really needed for the improvement in the quality of education. But as my colleague told already, ICT initiatives have to be implemented, and our industries help us, but they should be cost effective. Because I am coming from General University. My name is Professor Rajasab from Tumkur University. General universities cannot afford that much of the cost which is projected by the industrial sectors here. Then, we know about MOOCs, we know about SPOCs, and all that ICT initiatives. No doubt it is good, but please understand, this Google, which represent ICT initiatives, if it can. Google cannot replace Guru. So even now, that Gurukula system, we have to understand, Guru can be improved by the use of Google, but Google itself cannot become Guru at any point of time. So we have to give much value to the students as well as to the teachers. We should remember who contributed zero, who and we are good in yoga, who gave us Shushruta Samhita, who was Aryabhata, then who discovered metal alloys, all these things. It is our predecessors. It is the Indian system. But from that glory, now we have moved on to another situation where we are depending on the foreign thoughts. But I tell you, our mindset is entirely different from the mindset of the foreign universities. For example, they are always, the foreign, especially Western universities, they are innovative in character, we are conservative in character. They produce leaders, we produce followers. They are the engines of growth, we remain bogies. They are not afraid of change, we are afraid of change. They embrace change, whereas we are resist the change. They always discard outdated system, we follow outdated system. They are good in research and innovation, we are non-innovative. They teach tomorrow's knowledge, we teach yesterday's knowledge. They produce entrepreneurs, we produce job seekers. This is reality. So, from the age of zero invention, mathematics, astrophysics, then metal alloys, Shushruta Samhita, yoga, we gave to the whole country, now we are following them. We can follow them with regard to technology, not with regard to the original thinking. We have to make our students to think, make our student to think innovatively, and think what is best to our society, for our education system. We need not worry that we are not one among the 200 universities in the world. The yardsticks that they have used to measure the university is entirely wrong system, which cannot be adapted to the Indian system. So we should develop our own rating system, rating categories. So in no way Indian universities are less than any other universities with regard to the originality of thinking. Only thing is, we have to make our student to come out with their innovative research and thinking. If you say that our universities are not doing well, how is that our university students are doing well in foreign countries? They may not be doing well here, but when they go abroad, they do excellently. That means to say that we have that potential. Only thing, we have to identify a methodology so that a guru and student can understand one another, learn from one another, and get the values of the Indian heritage and do something good and bring back the pride of India. Thank you very much.
Amazing speech. Thank you very much.